Alright, welcome to the video. As we continue the practice of gradually moving our comfort zone towards the truth. I taped last night, but I was so depressed. It wasn't a very good taping. But I was able to turn things around. So I feel a lot better today. Getting depressed means nobody is going to believe the truth if you tell them. I realize that. I know nobody's going to understand or believe it. That's depressing. But what I can say is that whether anyone understands it or not, the truth is that gradually moving your comfort zone, meaning gradually evaporating the continuity problem, is what works. So nobody can prevent you from gradually moving your comfort zone towards the complete self-evidency of God, the complete self-evidency of reality of God, not needing the slightest explanation whatsoever. All right. Totally self-evident. There's no need for words experiencing the complete self-evidency of it, that God is perfectly fresh, always, right now. All potential is right now. There's no way to lose any potential of reality at all, ever. You know, all this is completely self-evident. So all we have to do is experience it. So we move our comfort zone towards experiencing God, actually. So call upon God, that's what I've been doing. And this is extremely helpful, actually. Extremely helpful. Okay. So feeling better. But depression, despondency does come, absolutely. Often when you glimpse the truth, you become very despondent because you say, nobody will believe me. I can't help anybody, which is true. Nobody will believe you. They'll say, but that's completely different than what I was expecting. Or, you don't expect me. I can't accept that. My continuity, my familiarity is not there. Exactly. That's why I say, in this world, the practice is paramount. And that is every daily moving your comfort zone closer, 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 so you feel comfortable with no explanation, with self-evidency, with experiencing. There isn't any other way. Those who keep waiting for an explanation are wasting their time. Again, God is perfectly self-evident with no need for any explanation whatsoever. And this is what we must come to accept. And, okay. So it's the practice, it's the culture of practice is what is important. Nothing is important other than that. The culture of practice of moving the comfort zone. This is it. This is the key. This is the secret. So it's an open secret. Nothing succeeds like familiarity, right? You can't beat it. You cannot beat that. And those who think, well, I don't have time for that. I can generate some clever answer at some point. Wasting their time. So I believe it says in biblical quote, he who persevereth, those who persevereth till the end, he being neutral pronoun, so includes everyone, shall be saved. He who persevereth to the end shall be saved. Persevereth to the end. Okay, meaning keep moving your comfort zone. It's not glamorous, but it's fantastic because you begin to glimpse the truth and you say, wow, I'm getting close. I'm closing in. Oh, I'm closing in on this. Yeah. Okay. And you realize, okay, nobody, you cannot explain this to anyone at all. God is perfect. Nothing's ever happened. You can say that each moment is just a tableau, a mise-en-scene tableau snapshot, as it were. This is what's appearing this instant. Each moment, this is just what's appearing. There's nothing other than that. And we are simply staging a photograph, staging a scene. being photographed. This whole world, what we call a world, doesn't really exist at all. It's each moment is this staging for a photograph, for a snapshot. This instant, this is what's appearing. And we're trying to give this appearance of depletion, of change, depletion, dying, falling apart, things are not right, out of balanceness. So all this scene that we're setting up, each moment is just a scene we're setting up, taking a snapshot of it, trying to produce a picture of changing God, actually. This is what's going on. God has not changed in the slightest bit. But we're so preoccupied with shifting the scenery for the next shot. Oh, I feel tired. Oh, I'm aging. Oh, here's an aging body. This aging body, just this instant, is just an appearance of light. It's just an appearance of light. And this snapshot, every instant is an instant where we're giving this appearance. And we think that this appearance somehow means that God is being changed. And it's not true, because each instant is completely fresh, completely clean, completely fresh, completely spontaneous, without any depletion of the pure potentiality of reality, which is never ever is the pure potentiality of all expressions ever depleted from any appearances or expressions, not in the slightest bit. Again, we could generate infinite universes each instant, and that forever, and that would never deplete the pure potentiality one bit, not one bit. Nor would there be any residue, nor any depletion. Reality would still be perfectly fresh. Perfectly fresh. God is always perfectly fresh. Never depleted in the slightest bit. This is the nature of reality. So all this attempt to stage this idea of depletion is not depleting anything, God. Not depleting. All is God. All is God. It's not depleted at all. Just a mere, this is mere appearance. We're just posing. You're just striking a pose. Oh, here's an old, I'm old, I'm tired. You know, I'm a body, I'm a form. These are just all appearances, just poses. And again, those who hear this in the context of getting used to hearing it, those are the ones who are making progress. See, so don't be in too much of a hurry. What happens to people that they're trying to be, well, let's give us a moment to get used to this before we race forward. See, that's the key, right? Give yourself a moment to get used to it before you race forward. Whoever has this patience are the ones who will succeed in realizing they don't need to know anything. The reality is totally self-evident. It's effortlessly self-evident. There's nothing they have to figure out. There's no teaching that is needed, actually. There's no teaching, no teacher, no student is necessary. Because reality is completely self-evident. For all. Totally self-evident for all. There's never any situation where reality is not totally self-evident. Never. So do we need a savior? No. There's nothing to be saved, really, right? Reality is perfectly self-evident for all. This is the case right now. Do we need it to put this into some teaching, into some format? No. No, actually you cannot. You cannot put pure, perfect self-evidency into some format, into some teaching, into, you know, cannot. Nobody needs to be saved. Everything, all is God, right this instant, always. There's never a situation where any saving needs to take place whatsoever. Even saying all are saved is not true, because there was never any situation they need to be saved from, ever. It's like someone striking a pose for a photograph. The photographer says, okay, now look tired. Oh, okay, I'm tired. Striking a pose of tiredness. Is God tired? No. So, and all is God. All is God. All is God. There's nothing separate from God. All is God. All is the nature of God. The nature of God is all. Nothing is separate from it. Nothing is an exception. There's no exceptions, no exemptions at all. So the feeling is that one is closing in on the truth, getting closer. That's the feeling. Okay, that's right. This then gives the jitters. This is good. When you get the jitters, that's good. Don't turn to the intellect at that point to bail you out. Just the opposite. Just sort of sink into the jitters and just calm. Don't struggle with the jitters. Don't struggle. Just say, oh, this is great. Good. Just need to be patient now. Because we are here. What we're hearing here is just, we haven't heard it before. Sung this way, right? The singing gets clearer and stronger and stronger. And each time we hear it clearer and stronger, it's like, whoa, wow. I feel lifted up, you know, out of delusion, as it were. Like the light, I'm seeing the light, you know. And this gives us the jitters. But don't distract yourself from the jitters either. I see this is also a problem. Just kind of remain neutral. That's it. But not as an observer, because that's trying to take a position on it. Don't take the position on it either. You're just sort of neutral. You're feeling it. Say okay. Full stop. Just that's okay. Sort of like you're sprinting and you're out of breath. Just slow to a jog. All right, this is a very good way to speak of it. Just slow down to a jog, or even a walk, because you're out of breath. You'll be climbing a hill, and it's like you're really out of breath. It's like, you know you're getting in good shape. Just walk for a little while. Just walk. Don't stop. Just sort of, okay, keep walking, but just you're walking now. You're not sprinting. Don't underestimate the severity of the continuity fear. And also realize that what we're talking about here is very profound. Incredibly profound. So of course it's going to bring about this jitters, like, whoa, I'm getting very close. I'm really closing in on this. Really closing in. Keep the body quiet. No fidgeting or scratching or acting out. Just keep it quiet. Just walking. And after a little while, then we'll start jogging again. And after you start jogging, maybe break into a run again. It's like that. Very much like that. Kind of like cross training of or some sort of training, where you're building up your capacity, we're building up our capacity to accept no explanation, the absolute beauty of no explanation, this is the real quote-unquote path, is going towards the absolute beauty of no explanation, which is experiencing the complete self-evidency of truth, where there's nothing to figure out, nothing to explain, nothing to express. So, it's possible, as what we do here in these videos, is to, we use words to point to move us closer to no words. No explanation. Use explanations to move us closer to no explanation. This is what a quote-unquote teacher, a sharer, helper, whatever, encourager, can do. Paradoxical. We may not seem we're making any much progress as we just slow down here, but we're making incredible progress. Because remember, the progress is towards no explanation. Isn't the world demanding explanations? Absolutely it is. This is the problem with the world. Very few come into this world and are able to withstand this demand. I wasn't able to. But very few are. So it's not something to be ashamed of, that you come into this world and cannot withstand the pressure here. Very, very few. Very few are able to withstand the pressure. The demand for explanation, which is never ending, right? You start explaining, and they demand more, and they demand more, and demand more. One question leads to 10 more. 10 more leads to 100 more. More demand, explanation. What they're really saying is, we cannot accept the fact that truth is completely self-evident, because we believe we've changed it. Okay, that's this world. This is the belief system of this world. So who can just maintain this stance, no, truth is completely self-evident, no explanation is required? Who can maintain that in this world? Very few. And they stand out in history. And whatever speech they give is to help us move our comfort zone. That's all. It's not a contradiction to give explanation. The explanation is to help us move towards no explanation. We explained that no explanation is needed. For those who believe an explanation is needed, of course you'd have to interact with them. You have to explain, since they're totally used to believing the explanation is absolutely essential. You have to explain to them that explanation isn't needed. That's obviously. Otherwise, there would be no inner communication or sharing at all. And you have to tell them they have a continuity problem. This is the first thing you have to tell them, is that you're scared of you know, no explanation. Gives you the jitters. Super important. Anytime there is a turning towards this no explanation, self-evidency, these jitters will arise. And so we have to accept this fact. This is called the mood of repentance. Mood of repentance is to accept the fact that jitters arise as I start to turn towards no explanation. Whoa, jitters arise. This is humility. Be meek, humble, unassuming, and mood of repentance, meaning, of course the jitters are going to arise for me, and then full stop in the now, in the burn of these jitters, full stop in the jitters. Don't race around when you start feeling the jitters. Don't trying to act like it's merely enthusiasm, and then start acting out all this enthusiasm. No, that's delusional. See, that's what short circuits the path. Fear. Recognize it. And say, oh, okay, great. It means you're making great progress, is what it means. So honor the progress and say, full stop in the progress here. Let me not detach from it and claim it's something else. Like it's just, oh no, I'm feeling super enthusiastic. No, you're feeling very jittery. Which again was why I say caffeine is not good, because that can produce this artificial jitteriness. You don't want that. You don't want that. You want to be able to recognize genuine jitteriness in you. That means, oh my gosh, I'm crossing the street, you know, to this unknown, it's not unexplainable. It doesn't need any explanation. You're relaxing into non-dual abidance is what's happening. You're relaxing into it. And so jitters will arise, and the way is, don't force it. Just say, okay, let me get used to this. Let me move my comfort zone to where I am right now and just get used to it. This is the way, incrementally. Now, of course, the leap of faith, the quantum leap, is in leaping, realizing no leap is needed, no explanation is needed at all. God does not require an explanation from us as to why God is God, as to why we're not in trouble. God doesn't need us to explain that why we're not separate from God. See, no explanations needed. And this is what staggers our mind, because our mind is the explainer, the little mind, so to speak, the egoic mind. That's the explainer. This is the mechanism of explanation. And we hear no explanation. So we don't need the I, the explainer. No one needs the explainer. This is true right now. It's not that someone, Savior, goes to God and explains to God how it is that we are separate from God, and how we reconcile the separation, or how we've changed reality and how we've managed to fix it or stop changing it. And, you know, no explanation needed. There's no Savior that goes to God and explains a non-existent situation to God. Reality doesn't require any explanation whatsoever. So this is the shock of, like, no one needs to explain anything to God. There's no explanation is needed whatsoever. Why do we need to explain why the impossible never happened? It's not needed. It's not needed. We don't need to explain at all. Reality is totally self-evident. We don't need to explain why it's self-evident to us. So it didn't used to be self-evident, but now it is. No, it's always been self-evident. So, well, we changed it for a while, but now it's changed back. No, it never changed. So I is not needed. Now, is this causing jitters? Absolutely. Absolutely. It's causing jitters in me. So I'm just, you know, showing how the path goes. We use the pathless path, not even the pathless path, but how moving our comfort zone goes. See, moving a comfort zone is not really a path. It's we're simply moving our comfort zone into accepting where we've always been. That we never left where we've always been. In fact, there's no we don't need to give an explanation of how it is we managed to not move. See, this is the key to it. We don't need to give an explanation as to, well, how do we manage to not move? God, I never moved at all from where I am, and I need to explain how it is that I didn't manage to move. No, that explanation isn't needed. That's the belief that God somehow told us we were supposed to move, and so we need to explain how we failed to do so, you know, or there was some temptation to move. All of that implies that moving is possible, and it's not possible. So why do we need to explain to God what is not possible? Who needs to explain what is not possible to God? God already knows what's not possible. God's will is all So if this doesn't produce the jitters, then you're already enlightened and you don't need to listen to this at all. Or you're, you know, walling it off, resistant to it. That's it. That's all. Too much. It's too much. So this is phase four teaching. And that's too much for phase one, two, and three, for the most part. This is more direct, more simple, direct. Phase four is very simple, very direct. Just full stop in the jitters. No explanation. Nothing to explain. There isn't anything. We don't need to explain how the impossible didn't happen. How we managed to avoid doing the impossible. We don't need to explain that. Because we didn't manage to avoid it. Because we can't manage to avoid the impossible. So it's not like we realize God. We say, yeah, God, I finally realized you. And it's due to my my great genius managing to avoid accomplishing the impossible. Right? So you don't return home. It's not a returning home. It's not a return at all. It's a realization you never left. And in fact, you can't leave. And more to the point, no one has ever left. No one is in any situation at all. Situations don't exist in reality. Circumstances do not exist. We think they're circumstances. There are no circumstances. There's just this, in this instant is this appearance, a staged appearance, or this is an appearance. It's just an appearance. The next moment can be anything at all, anything we like. So there's no situation, no circumstance, no situation. Therefore, there's no such thing as existence. Very important. There's no existence whatsoever. And no explanation as to why there's no existence. Because it's completely self-evident. The nature of reality is perfect freedom. So it's impossible to generate a circumstance. It's impossible to generate existence. Nothing has ever existed. There's never been any existence, and not even one instance of existence. There's never been even a single instant of existence. Never, never will be. So this sharing here is designed to give rise to the jitters. So if the jitters are coming, that's great. This is being effective then. It was effective. So we must practice full stop in this. Don't be looking for some dependency relationship. I need to latch on to someone who can protect me from this. I need to, you know, no, just full stop. No thought of interaction whatsoever. No need to do anything except just neutrally abide right where you are. Just neutrally abide right where you are. Do not think of people, do not think of bodies, do not think of relationships. Oh, that's existence. In other words, you're looking for some handle, some aspect to grab a hold of existence. You say, oh my gosh, I'm going towards no existence. How can I grab a hold of existence? See, obviously that's short-circuiting. Don't even think of teachers or gurus, our loved ones, or our hated ones. All, those are all handles you're trying to put on non-existence. You're trying to grab a hold of existence. So we say there's never been a single instant of existence. Full stop in the jitters of that. Again, do not use stimulants or drugs or anything like that, because that produces artificial buzz of, and you won't be able to determine for sure whether you're jittery or not. See, this is very important. And then your mind will just be too active. Your mind will be too active trying to discern, and you can't make a clear discernment. Okay, it's very important. When you're using caffeine, caffeine is the worst drug in the world without any, it interferes with the spiritual path to an extraordinary extent. The latest statistics are 83% of Americans, and maybe in other cultures it's even higher. I read somewhere like 92% of the world uses a caffeinated product every day, people in the world, adults will say. This is the worst plague in the world right now, is caffeine. The worst plague there is. It produces this artificial jittery buzz, where then your mind cannot discern, really, is this the jitters from spiritual clarity that I'm getting close to succeeding or not? You can't really make a clear discernment. And so you will start thinking too much. It's a combination of, and the music too that we listen to produces this sort of a buzz, and I call it sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Sex, caffeine, and modern music. The combination of all that eroticism, the constant sexing up the society through advertising, through, you know, the magazines, through the talk on, you know, it's just everyone is a combination of these three factors, which produces this sense of hubbub inside, and you cannot clearly discern. You can't feel like I'm making progress or not. It's not possible. And then your mind just churns faster and faster. Then you can't sleep, go into depression, all this stuff. So it's super important to knock out the sex, drugs, and rock and roll, which has always been the way in throughout history of the spiritual path, saying, look, you have to have these virtues. You have to exclude certain things. Very important. And you have to, somehow the Holy Spirit will turn you away from that. It's called cleaning up your life, turning away from that. Those three, the combination of those three, the eroticism, the hard driving mute, the music, the emotionalized hard driving music, and the caffeine, all of this is produces a background hum buzz where you cannot discern clearly, and this then overstimulates your thinking and builds the ego up, because you think, I need to think more, think more. What we're doing, we're flipping the script. Okay. No sex, no drugs, no rock and roll. Okay. Absolutely. Stay away from those like they're the worst plague. Way worse than Ebola, way worse than bird flu, way worse than any plague, cancer, AIDS, you name it. Way worse than that, okay, is this modern plague. It's a spiritual plague. It prevents you from clear discernment. Most certainly it does. And I don't care if you're super advanced on the path, if you get into that syndrome, you'll lose your discernment. So what's more important, explanation or discernment? Discernment is more important. So you have to be in touch with your jitters, as I say. Not with your feelings or emotions or stuff, no. This is a spiritual discernment we're talking about here. You have to be aware, in touch with your reactions to truth. You have to be in touch with this reaction, this one reaction of feeling nervous, jittery, because you're relaxing in to where you've always been. To no explanation, to self, perfect self-evidency. This continuity fear, as I say, is the only problem there is. You only have to be in touch with this, the dynamic of the continuity fear. That's it. Don't have to be in touch with anything else. Don't have to be concerned with anything else other than this. This is the only problem we have. But you most definitely have to be aware of this dynamic of the continuity fear. And if you're not, you won't be able to make progress on the path. You will not. And you will overthink it, overreact it, overthink, and you'll spin your wheels. You'll be spinning your wheels for sure. Been there and done that. Stay away from all that terrible trifecta that has dragged the world down into a situation where it's not able to recognize spiritual progress at all. It's oblivious. And as I said, July 2016, the world will reach a point where it will conclude that there's no such thing. There's no such goal. Must not, can't be. You get, so. The caffeinization, the eroticization, the rock and rollization of the world, the jangledness, you know, of it. Okay, the hyped up jangleness, it prevents us from clearly discerning. And when the world no longer thinks that it can discern clearly at all, and thinking this is normal, natural, it will say, well, there must be nothing to discern. And at that point, you enter into the extreme darkness. And I say by July 2016, this world will enter into this extreme darkness where they conclude that there's nothing to discern. And so all of this stuff about God realization, it's all a myth, it's all nonsense, it's all, what they will do was they will conclude it's insanity. Okay, this is what is going to happen. It's already tacitly there in many people in the world, but they don't quite feel quite ready to make this leap. Okay, what happened is July 2016 is a leap of delusion, a leap into delusion where people will feel compelled like lemmings to leap off the cliff and say there's nothing to discern. There is no quote-unquote goal except this thinking and what we can do with our thinking. And anyone who says otherwise is insane and unable to go with the script and therefore is essentially dead to us, doesn't exist, well, like that. So it'll be a leap into the belief in existence. A quantum leap into delusion, so to speak. So we most certainly want to have moved our comfort zone a great deal before that time. And it's getting more and more difficult, more and more difficult. But all the various pieces are being put in place in the world for those who are promoting this abject cave-in to delusion. They're all in place in the world, and they're pushing this agenda, and they're trying to create this stampede. Okay, I'm telling you, what I mean is that by July of 2016, a stampede will happen. Okay, this is what I'm saying. There are those many agents who are working to create this stampede. It's an ideological stampede of our attention. Okay. Which is designed to produce conclusions, which will then set a belief system in place, okay, which will then determine where your attention goes. And this will be the New World Order. Okay. So the stampede, I believe, will happen in 2016, July of 2016. That's sort of a threshold, is what I've been ballpark. And And so once a stampede happens, see, everyone's swept up in it. For example, in the Great Plains of North America, continent here, there used to be vast herds of buffalo, bison. And the Indians here, the Native Americans, knew how to, what they'd do is they would sort of move them through use of fire and various ways they had of scaring them. Towards a cleft, there were some areas, like a river would be cutting through the plains area, and there'd be an area where there's a sharp drop-off, okay, a cliff. And they would try to maneuver the bison towards that cliff area, because obviously the bison, unable to scramble down a hillside, would fall off the cliff to their death below. And then they would try to stampede the bison over that cliff. And once they started spooking enough bison, the overall push would be so strong that you would push even the ones that are not spooked, they would be pushed over the edge too, you see. I think they'd dress up in, you know, costumes of wolves or something and go among the bison, you know, acting, pretending that they're a wolf or something. They're very clever of how to generate a stampede. So this technology, this know-how, how to bring about a stampede in society is something that the saboteurs know very well, and they've gotten into positions of extreme power in society and culture and politics, etc. And they're working, ideologically working, to spook us into a stampede. Now again, I have said that even the bison that were not spooked were pushed over the cliff by the sheer numbers and force of the herd, you see. So what I've been warned about my whole life is that there will be this stampede at some point in this world. And you don't want to get caught up in that stampede. So how exactly to sidestep it? We are open to that clarity as well. We do not want to be stampeded back into delusion. But it's a potential. It could potentially happen. Perhaps I'm aware of that. I feel the pressure is just intense in this world. Just intense. Intense effort to eroticize the planet, to caffeinize the planet, to rock and rollize the planet. You know, the music is the three factors. Those are three very powerful factors that end up making us very susceptible to being stampeded, because we're out of touch with the continuity fear dynamic. If we're in touch with the continuity fear dynamic, we have confidence and say, I know I'm going to succeed. I'm moving my comfort zone. I'm aware I'm making progress. And I feel I have a tremendous faith that this is going to succeed. And you know you have the capability. So it's all important to be in touch with this continuity fear dynamic and how we can move our comfort zone by considering truth, turning our attention to no explanation, turning our attention towards no explanation. And feel the jitters of this and get used to it. Let it calm down. Just stay peacefully calm and just don't struggle with the struggle. And we say, you know, there is a way of right practice to succeed. No question about it. So we're not insane in doing this at all. We don't need to delay. We do not need to go into a cycle of delay at all. We do not need to be stampeded. And so you see in history how important it has been to de-emphasize all this stimulation and to put, you know, restrictions on it. Very crucial in culture, in your personal life, in the culture, society. Severe restrictions on this. Otherwise, you're doomed. You're doomed to failure. You will not succeed. You will be unable to work with this continuity problem and move your comfort zone all the way to the end. Persevere to the end. You will not. And then you will make up rationalizations for why you didn't persevere to the end. And then you will blame others. You'll project it, rationalize, and attack, and all of this. All of this. Here, living in the heart of paganism in the Silicon Valley, I can feel how unwelcome all this is. You know, it's like a very harsh lesson of how extremely unwelcome I feel the presentation of this culture, people, and the way that's presented here. And I just feel, wow, that's totally not welcome at all. No, thank you. The hyped up attitude, the extreme attraction to bodies here. Same thing like in Hollywood and LA, maybe even in some ways worse there, but here it's also has its own extreme unwelcomeness. The go, 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 caffeinated, hyped up, you know, bodies, beautiful. Everyone is into showing how incredibly beautiful their body is. You know, it's just and how you're supposed to be hyped up about that, you know, which means getting out of touch with this continuity fear issue. So you could say it's like the antithesis of what is needed. Silicon Valley is the antithesis of what is needed. The whole Hollywood syndrome is also the antithesis. Antithesis of what is needed. The antithesis of what is helpful. The opposite of it. And this is the globalization. You might say the globalization of the opposite of what is needed. Some people say it's the Antichrist. Well, it's the opposite of what is needed to realize Christ, which is God, actually. God is all. Christ is the allness of God, the experiencing of the allness of God. All is God. All is God. So the Antichrist means that which interferes with our realization, interferes with our accepting no explanation is needed. That's what that which distracts our attention. Because we do have a continuity fear. Even though we've never moved at all, we believe we have. So the realization we've never moved is shocking to us. We have a tendency to think there's something wrong with us, that we should have been able to move out of God or change God. And so we think, well, maybe something's gone wrong with me. I should be able to do this. No, we cannot do the impossible. God did not create us with the capacity, any capacity whatsoever, to change God. So nothing is wrong with us. But believing that now, don't be afraid to just stop. If you feel the jitters coming on, just stop. Mid-sentence. You don't have to complete any sentence or thought. See, it's very important. You do not have to complete any thought or sentence or concept or explanation. You do not have to complete it. In fact, one of the practices can be giving explanations and just stopping in the middle of it. Just stopping again in the middle of it. Ready to start. I said, no, just stop. Enough explanations already been given. The jitters are already there. See, the jitters are already there. And that's why the caffeine, if I would had been drinking coffee, I would have just gone on and on and on and on and on. That doesn't help. But because I'm calm, you know, in this practice, I recognize, hey, wait a minute. Let's just stop right there. Here come the jitters, the bikers, funny. So like this when I'm taping, this huge posse of motorcycles, I didn't even know they were coming. To stop, right? So, when a motorcycle, posse of motorcycles is coming by, a horde, just go quiet. This is like the jitters, okay? Just, and then they pass, right? Now they're gone. Someone is coming. Okay, better stop the taping for a minute. Just let it pass. Dark cloud is coming, thundercloud. Remember, in doing this continuity here, you're under shelter, actually. So you see a dark thunderstorm cloud. Did you get up and say, oh, wait a minute, I panicked? No. Just say, okay, I just sit here. Let it pass. It's going to rain heavily. Just let it pass. But if you're all hyped up, you won't be able to determine. You like, feel like you're hallucinating. I'm not sure, is that it, or is my imagination, or whatever. But when you're calm, you're not caffeinated, you're not hyped up in any way, artificially hyped up, and hyped up by nature, hyped up in any way. No sex, no drugs, no rock and roll are hyping you up. Then you're able to discern properly. Say, oh, I see that this, I'm feeling this jitters, and it's due to my attention. Where I'm placing my attention. I'm placing my attention on no explanation. Wow. And then you feel totally justified in saying, whoa, let me stop. What happens when you get all hyped up, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, is you lose your discernment and your confidence, and you start psyching yourself out. And then you get anxiety. Very bad. Because you're saying, well, I'm not sure if this is real jitters or not, so I'm not really sure if I should stop now or not. I'm not sure, I'm not sure, I'm not sure, I'm not sure. And then you get all freaked out. You get freaked out. You get freaked out. Happens on people on drugs all the time. In the 60s we call it freak out. Someone's freaked out. Is you lose your discernment. Now for some people who are very animalistic. They enjoy that, you know, and so drugs don't seem to bother us much. But for those who really want to succeed in accepting that no explanation, accepting God, discernment's super important. And so the sex, drugs, and rock and roll syndrome is very unwelcome for them. Whereas others who are trying to get, believing they're an animal, their body, their form, process, nature, they relish that stuff. And it doesn't seem to affect them because it just strengthens their delusion. It strengthens their delusion, which is what they want. So this is a confusion that should be pointed out. That those who want to strengthen delusion, they seek the more sex, the more eroticism, the more drugs, caffeine, whatever drugs they can, the more rock and roll, the more chaos they can produce. They say, oh, I love this, this is great. Because it seems to be protecting them from no explanation. That's what they want, they're building their defense system. But to those who want to drop their defense system, that stuff's very bad. Very, very bad. Extremely unwelcome. Which is why some people homeschool their kids. They don't want to send their kids to these insane asylums of schools where all this defensiveness is being built up. I should have never been sent to school. I didn't want to go to school at all. I said, this place is super toxic for me. But back then, we really didn't have homeschooling. So I just wanted to run away, you know, it was like torture every day. So the traditions are traditions because they work, because this is what is necessary. The calm, the peace. It's for the purpose of discernment. So that you can discern and not get into this freak out mode. And the problem is when you get in this freak out mode, then you want to quit. You say, wow, I don't even want to try. This is terrible. This is a big problem. That's why many have quit during this siege that the world's under. It's really a siege. It's under siege. Barbarians have been at the gates for quite some time. It's a siege to destroy your discernment. And many have freaked out, and they say, well, I can't handle this. I can't discern, so forget it. Let me just say there's no discernment, nothing to discern. And so they think, okay, the answer is there's nothing to discern. Okay, good, I forget all about it, and just live my life and get by as best I can, and that's it. So they dropped out of the spiritual path. Now, it's been very difficult to stay on the spiritual path these last 50, 60 years, to say the least. So certainly, it's understandable why many will have dropped out. Most have dropped out, actually. But on the other hand, it's also a fact that this time is the time of the siege, and being here in this world is a great excuse to drop out of the spiritual path. We have this wonderful excuse, oh, I couldn't help it, you know. But remember, there are no excuses, there are no exemptions or exceptions. So it's merely a delay is all it is. You cannot move one iota from where you already are. You cannot change reality one iota. It's impossible. Reality is perfectly self-evident, so no explanation is ever needed for reality, none whatsoever. So no I is ever needed, ever. So again, it's just delay, it's just dropping out is delay. But I would say going forward is those who have dropped out, I'm trying to pick their spirits up and saying, okay, try again. Regulations, very strict in terms of what your culture is about. And we had a good run through the last 2,000 years of strictness, okay? And finally the barbarians finally broke down the gates. Okay, fine. We had this time where we at least were able to consider to some extent. And we didn't quite get it. Okay, that's fine. Next time, we will. See, next, make sure you have a next phase where you focus way more intensely on the one, there's only one problem. This is continuity fear. And only one discernment is to discern the dynamics of this continuity fear. And just focus on that. That's it. So, the barbarians have broken down the gates and sacked Rome, as it were. But not really Rome, but have sacked the citadel of spiritual discernment. And those will be driven into exile. Supposed exile. Those who want spiritual discernment will be driven into exile. But it's not really exile. It's actually another opportunity. So look at it that way. So don't fear this time is coming up, exile, because what I'm saying is my discernment is still here. And I'm still aware of the continuity fear, the dynamic, and I know it is possible. This avenue to truth never disappears. It's that simply you have to begin practicing the discernment and moving your comfort zone. That's all. Very easy and very simple. But not if there's this cacophony of chaotic stimulus, animalistic, stimulus. Then certainly you won't be able to do it. It'd be super difficult, and you may drop out again. So there has to be these requirements, these stipulations, these rules, these of that keep that stuff away. Absolutely. It can be done on an individual basis, even under these circumstances. It's difficult, for sure. It's better if there's a supporting culture, for sure, where there's, there's no access to this stuff at all. There's no access to it. So it seems like a paradox, but I'll tell you this. In a world where there is no internet, for instance, no pornography, no internet, no ability to produce all these very clever outfits, no caffeine, no drugs, and no electrical musical instruments, for instance, and even where when there's rules and laws against certain type of music, like there used to be in this world. In other words, you think it's very primitive, it's Middle Ages primitive. That's actually the highest, That is a situation that people absolutely, those who want to practice spiritual discernment, that's what they aim for. So it's a way higher culture than what we have now. What we have now is a extremely debased, dark culture. Extremely debased in terms of spiritual discernment. In other words, we're at a low, 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 low point. And the previous times were way higher than this time is. Way, way higher. It's like the opportunity to live in those times would be like, example, like taking a wonderful Hawaiian vacation or something now. Like, oh my gosh, I'd just love to go to such a... Are you kidding? So many monastic orders and spiritual retreats and places where you could literally live your entire life and practice this discernment with the world shut out. Are you kidding? That's absolutely fabulous. The opportunity was there to get to not be so severely distracted. That's the best. That is the best. This world now is horrible. I mean, this is the last thing you want. There's the internet And of course, because it's here, I'm using it. But giving, you can give a positive purpose to even the worst stuff, but it's way better if it's not even here at all. Okay. If this whole modern culture didn't exist, it would be way, way, way better for everyone. And of course, you can always find silver linings for everything. Okay. But you have to look at the total picture of spiritual discernment. How is our spiritual discernment? And the people who commentators, social commentators in the world, they have no clue about spiritual discernment. So how can they know whether this culture is good or not? Only those who are very aware of the path, very aware of what's needed, very aware of this dynamic of the continuity fear and how to make the right discernment, how to understand the jitters, how to do the full. Only those are really capable of determining what is a good culture, what is not, what is helpful, what is not. Those who have no clue about this, their opinions are worthless, absolutely worthless. And if you listen to those who are giving worthless opinions, you'll end up with worthless opinions as well. So you have to know the spiritual path, the path of discernment. You have to know that it's about moving your comfort zone and what discernment is necessary to succeed at this. You have to know it. You have to have been there, done that, in order to then look in at culture and say, okay, what is helpful and what is harmful for this? And if the people who are in positions of power in the world have no discernment whatsoever about this, which they don't, then how can they guide us correctly? They're blind leading the blind, is what we have in this world. So the slow pacedness of the past, the quietness, not much happening. Okay, so you can sit quietly and begin to work on turning your attention to this complete self-evidency. And then you can feel the jitters and say, okay, oh, I don't have to do anything. I can just sit here and pay attention to this. So again, in this modern culture, I'd say it's scraping the bottom of the barrel. Absolutely scraping the bottom of the barrel. Although it can get worse. Absolutely, it will get worse. So again, what kind of world do you want? What kind of experience do you want? You want some hustling, bustling metropolis and, you know, all of what's going on in this world, materiality? Or do you want like a calm, peaceful landscape? A little cave, a little hut, a little monastery, a nunnery, a priory, whatever. You want a simple life, where you can stop at any moment. Nobody's demanding, go, 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 go. You can say, hey, let me just stop right here. I don't have to complete this sentence. I don't have to complete this action. I got the jitters, that's great. Let me just stop here. Full stop in the jitters, full stop in the burn. Fortunate are the ones who find themselves in such a situation. Very fortunate. If you see someone else, you just let them be. You don't need to say, hey, I got a project here. I've got a big building project. Hey, I got to do. No, just let them be. Let them be. And they let you be. And you can sit there quietly. No need to relate or interact on a doing basis or explaining basis. Just moving closer to no explanation. Is what it's all about. Moving closer to no explanation is what it's all about. there's no explanation, meaning God doesn't need to be explained. Nothing is separate from God, so there's nothing in need of an explanation of God, actually. We just simply need to experience that and stop putting our attention on the fantasy hallucination. So people talk about how happy they are to get into Stanford University or something like that. You know, it's like the ultimate. That's not the ultimate. That's actually something you want to avoid at all costs. Getting into like a monastery, a nunnery or something, or a spiritual retreat, that's the ultimate. Or getting into a world that is set up that way, that's the ultimate. Almost the ultimate. Getting into supernature is the ultimate. Those are the ones who are really taking a path to success. It's like, wow. You know, those are the ones who really put the work in. Those are the ones who really are on the right track. No explanation doesn't mean I'm just going to remain confused at the mercy of nature or something. That doesn't what it means. It means that God is all, and there's no need to, nothing to explain to. And never separated. There's never been an instant of existence. No, not even an instant of existence, and no explanation is needed for this. Okay, this is a way of putting it. Jitters arise, of course, from this. There's never been even an instant of existence, and there will be, and there's no need for any explanation of this. This encapsulates the path very nicely. And we're trying to turn our attention to this so we can look at this, right? And most are so terrified they won't even try. Some will get quick glimpse and then, oh, you know, away. Jitters, soon so intense. Okay, fine. Move the comfort zone gradually. As I say, four phases, phase one, two, three, and four. And the setup has been that way, sort of, throughout history. Is you might have a monastery that's practicing phase four. A monastic retreat for either men or women most certainly should be kept separate. And you have then lay monastics who serve the monastery. Those can be like in phase three. Okay, those can be phase three people who are sort of absorbing some of the phase fourness and getting tuned into it. Then you can have around that a schooling, which is phase two, where people begin to study they begin to turn their attention towards this, still working with words, concepts, and complexity, and the gradual process of simplifying it. And then phase one would be the community surrounding the spiritual retreat, spiritual center. The community engaged in practicing purity of culture, rules and regulations that prepare them for phase two, three, and four. Super, you know, modesty in dress, modesty in demeanor, practicing the virtues. Of patience, forgiveness, non-stimulation, non-emotionalism, eating a simple diet, you know, restricting all of the animal sort of stimulations, the community would be practicing that. So you have this community, which, and they'd be working, and they'd help support, of course, the whole situation with food and whatever their work is done. This is the ideal setup. And this is the way it used to be in a lot of ways here in this world. In some regard. Not anymore. So you have a pious community. Piety is very important. Piety is very important. Super important for phase one. And then that can continue through phase two, three, and four. Now there may be times when people act out and get into trouble, and then they come back to it. That happens. So a very pious, very conservative community is all important. But this is part of the overall phase one, two, three, and four. And we're practicing the fourth phase now. And the funny thing is, in modern culture, it's all a mystery to us, isn't it? People think, oh, Dark Ages, Middle Ages, all that crazy stuff. Wow, such a mystery. If you look at it and study, those people are very intelligent. They know what they're doing. They understood the situation. Many have understood. But what I say is, right now we're at an all-time low point in the world for spiritual discernment. All-time low. It's funny, the higher the stock market goes, the lower the spiritual discernment in the world goes. The spiritual discernment index is in collapse. And I say it will collapse. I'm thinking of around July, mid-July of 2016. There will be this overall tremendous collapse of spiritual discernment where people will just be in tremendous confusion. Spiritual discernment, like a massive stock market collapse. Okay, if you look at spiritual discernment as like a stock market, what's going to happen is this massive collapse of spiritual discernment in the world, July 2016. So take your stock out of this world, I would say that. Take your stock out of it in some way. Certainly, practice piety. Limit as much as possible your exposure to the modern culture. I was getting my oil change recently, and in this place, the only magazine they have is like a People magazine. I said, what's this? I haven't looked at a People magazine in very, very long time. Maybe 15, 20 years. I don't know when it started publishing, but when it first came out, I took a look at it. So I looked at this, and it just like blew me away. I mean, it's just like so incredibly trashy, antichrist, that it was funny. It was so antichrist. Are you kidding me? I already believe what I was seeing. I mean, this is the Hollywood culture. It is so trashy. It is so antichrist. It is so unpious. There's the antithesis of what is needed. This just shows you a barometer of the collapse that is coming. It's so bizarre. It's almost interesting. You know, you have to be careful not to get caught up in the bizarre. Okay. Well, as I said, sometimes just stop in the middle of stuff is perfectly fine. Stop in the middle of any explanation, any clarification. Just full stop in the jitters. Very important. You don't have to go, 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 go. You see, if you got all this hyped up momentum, you feel like you gotta go, you gotta go, you gotta go, we gotta react, gotta react. And we can just stop right here, you see. Full stop in the now, full stop in the now. And we'll get back to it, right? We'll get back to it. Right now, there's a few things I need to do, so. Very great. Just maintain your patience, okay? Don't become overly impatient. Maintain your patience. Maintain your discernment of these jitters. No explanation. Not an instant of existence has ever occurred, and there's no explanation needed for that. Very great, and that is it.